there's a fair walk between the dressing room to the stage. And so you don't really hear the atmosphere in the room until you're maybe halfway down the corridor. When the house lights go off, the atmosphere really comes to life. And then the reality of the situation kicks in. It becomes very real. I think you do, over time, acclimate to the feeling that surrounds playing bigger gigs. And perhaps you'd be surprised at the things that would make me nervous.
Okay, welcome to the StageLeft podcast, lifting the veil on the music industry by telling the stories of those with a unique vantage point. This podcast exists to provide free educational content for young musicians entering an increasingly complex industry by telling the stories of some of the unsung heroes behind the success. Today is the first in our reconnection series where we invite back a guest from our 6-year span to see where they are in their career now. So interviewing John Waugh on episode 32 began a strong friendship that led to us becoming running partners, running 3 half marathons together for various charities, to John playing our live StageLeft Nights events in our lounge a couple of times. And John's career has gone from strength to strength since then. So he continues to be StageLeft, a saxophonist and keyboardist with 1975, and played integral parts on Sam Fender's number one record, Hypersonic Missiles, and collaborated with StageLeft guest, the legendary Bob Reynolds, as well as Mo Pleasure. John has both a new EP out and a new book out, which yours truly wrote a prologue to, so gushing it made John's mum cry. And he's on the cusp of returning to live gigs after a year out of the game. So there's been some virus or other, I think that's why he's not been playing any gigs. So it's a pleasure today. I've got a guest today on stage at podcast. It's none other than John Waugh. Thanks for joining us today, John. How's it going?
Very well, thank you. Thank you for having me.
You are the first person ever to appear on the podcast twice.
Well, it's my pleasure. Thank you very much.
So we've just done a run. Mm-hmm. 16 kilometres?
Yeah.
It was fun. We're both kind of a bit, our muscles are aching a little bit. We've done a lot of running in the last kind of couple of years. What does running do for you? Why is it a bit of escapism? Why is running so important to you?
Yeah, I think that's a nice way of putting it, the escapism. And I think it serves my mind just as much as my body. And so I'm not particularly bothered about being really physically fit. It's nice to know that I'm doing something to keep me healthy, but I think if I start my day with a run, it generally puts me in good stead to be productive and just generally a better person.
And when you tour, do you run? Do you get a chance to run in different parts of the world? I bet you do.
Yeah, and it's great. And the the touring party with the 975 are a very healthy bunch. and quite often, if we have, you know, the morning free, we'll get together in the hotel gym, or if we're somewhere particularly pleasant, we'll go for a run together. And so it I'm sure you'll be the same. It helps to have people to encourage you to get out the door and to go for a run. And so I try to do it as often as I can on tour.
We're recording this in April of 2021. And John came on the podcast kind of about 4 years ago, I think it was. And obviously something significant has happened in the last year or so, which we all know about. And everyone has been impacted by it. And it was interesting. I was looking at my phone recently, and the last kind of big night out that was normal was, you very kindly invited myself and Davila, my partner, to the O2, where the 1975 played an absolutely outrageous show to a full house, 20,000 people. It was absolutely amazing. That must seem a lifetime ago.
Yeah, it really does. Yeah.
And where do you think you'll be playing venues in the same way as that? Do you know, can you see that at any point in the near future? Or?
I think for it to be the same as how it was then, in my mind, and I, you know, what do I know? But I'm, for damage limitation, I would say next year, 2022. I think that's the only way where it's not just feasible, but also for the general public to have the confidence to be out in their droves. And so I like to think hopefully it'll be next year.
And that night, I remember it was incredible to see. It was the first time I'd seen the band, and it felt like, I said to you afterwards, like the whole of the O2 had been plugged in. It was so electric, like everyone was so excited. There was such an energy in the room. It'd be really interesting for a show to that scale. If you could walk us through what that is like, you know, the sensory element to it, walking out on stage, hearing the crowd, the sights, the smells, the sounds, not only walking on stage, but also when you're kind of coming on to do a song that you have a very prominent part in.
Well, with bigger venues like that, the dressing rooms are often quite detached from the venue itself, from the room that you perform in. And especially with buildings like the O2, it's so enormous that, you know, there's a fair walk between the dressing room to the stage. And so you don't really hear the atmosphere in the room until you're maybe halfway down the corridor to the stage. And usually, because we're not a very rock and roll bunch, I'm not going to say that we're boring, because we're not, but we tend to enjoy having less people in the dressing room before we go out and perform. And so we go from being in this quieter environment, which is very comfortable, and people are warming up and getting changed and getting ready, and then we tend to gather and congregate with everyone else that's working on the gig, and then we go out onto the stage, and then you get a real sense of the room, and the atmosphere really comes to life when the house lights go off, and and you hear that crowd, and then the reality of the situation really kicks in. It becomes very real, and I suppose the atmosphere in the room becomes very tangible, and so that, especially early on in the tour when the show is very new, there's new material being performed, it's a very exciting moment. And then to be on stage, it's this huge of release. You have all of this built up anticipation and tension and nervous energy, and then it just sort of either comes out in a very explosive way, depending on the nature of the music, or it just eases itself out over the course of the performance. And with that in mind, I suppose for me, I'm on and off stage a fair amount throughout the gig. And so I don't always play on the first song. It depends on how the set list has been arranged. So it's quite bizarre sometimes to walk out into the room and you hear all of that energy, then the crowd goes wild for the stage and I'm just waiting to go on for the second tune or something.
What's going through your mind in that kind of, during that first song?
Well, I suppose, yeah, you just have a slight continuation of that anticipation. But I think you do over time acclimate to the feeling that surrounds playing bigger gigs. Perhaps you'd be surprised at the things that would make me nervous. It's not always the grandeur of a gig or the size of a venue, or it's often smaller intricacies in my own performance that I think I dwell on probably too much, and so they come to mind, like you mentioned a moment ago, before a tune that I'm more heavily featured in. And even if a solo sounds simple, I still think about the minutiae behind the technique that's required to play it, or the quality of tone or intonation, all of these more musically driven things. I really hone in on those a lot. And so I think I just make sure that I'm just relaxed enough to try and cast some of that aside, I suppose, and just enjoy the...
It must be interesting for you to have to kind of come on and off and just perform. Like, there's no kind of wiggle room in regards to, like, you can't really ease yourself into the gig. Like, for others, you might be on stage for an hour and a half, and, if things don't kind of feel right at first, you can kind of move with things. But it's just literally, you've got to come on and bang.
Yeah.
Perform. Do your thing, John.
Yeah. And more often than not, I'm playing solos that happen maybe over the bridge of a tune, or the outro or the final chorus. So I'll walk on stage to play, but then I'm still standing there for maybe 2 or 3 minutes before I then actually play a note. And so I haven't really, for most of the tunes, I don't even hear myself playing in my in-ears until the solo starts. And quite a lot of the saxophone solos are quite high and 80s inspired, and so they require quite a lot of conviction to play well. And at first, I think on earlier tours, my method would be, right, well, just be as prepared as I can be, then just go for it and don't think about it. Whereas I think now, with a little bit more experience, it's just easier to deal with those moments, and you don't really give it too much thought. And I think I always feel far more comfortable with my performance, and can look back in hindsight at a gig and worry less if I know that I just was just, relaxed and prepared. And
there's something you said there that I'd like to pick up on, that I think is interesting for young musicians as well who might be listening to this, which is, you talked about how for that particular band, you don't really like having too many people in the changing room or the green room beforehand. And some bands are different to that. And from your personal perspective, if you've got lots of friends and family, does that end up being lots of like very short conversations? Well, like moving on around the people,
yeah.
And just, you really want that to bat them away, really, to afterwards.
Yeah, and it's probably more of my failing, I think, because I get really stressed if I have friends and family at a gig, and I know that they won't mind me saying that because I've spoken quite openly to them about this. Is that at like a Newcastle gig or a London gig where I've got a lot of friends and family there, and you see them before and after the gig? All that I really want to do is just sit quietly with the band and just, and not even, you know, get myself into a mindset where I need to be ready for the gig. It's just, I like sitting quietly before a gig. I think if there's too much of a social interaction, I think for whatever reason, I can never relax in those situations.
Is it because it's a loss of focus, or is it just there's too many, you know, people messaging outside?
It's almost like, so there is that. If someone is on the guest list, but for whatever reason, their name isn't down there. I always do my best to politely say, look, if you could do me a favor and get there an hour before the gig starts, that if something goes wrong, I've got the time to speak to our tour manager assistant to get it sorted out. And there's been a handful of occasions where I'll have my saxophone on me and I'm warming up and we've got 10 minutes before we walk on stage to a sold out arena. And I've just made the assumption that my friends and family are in. And then I'll get a text saying, the guy on the door saying our name's not on and blah, blah, blah. And so I'll frantically run around. And it's just the last thing that I want to do before playing a headline gig with, you know, a big pop band, obviously. And so it's just those silly little things that I suppose I get quite anxious about.
Yeah, and I think anybody would no one would really enjoy that situation. 10 minutes before going on, wow, that is a distraction. And then kind of earlier on in during the day, are you quite, I mean, as you say, you do this so much with the band that it might feel like just a day job now in some ways, but the you know, going out to restaurants during the day, or kind of what do you do to occupy yourself? And is the fact you have a gig that night kind of on your mind the whole time, or is it just a case of it's just another day?
I think, yeah, when you're even 2 or 3 weeks into a new tour campaign, I feel like I get quite settled into my role within the gig pretty quickly. And so I can get to a stage where I can really enjoy the performance and I don't get stressed at all about it. And so through the day, if I've got spare time, I love going out to explore the places that we travel to, and, you know, any opportunity to get a sense of the place that we're in. I think it's really important. Otherwise, you spend the majority of your career just sitting in rooms and corridors of arenas or whatever it is. And I can remember maybe when I was younger, the idea of that still sounded really exciting because it involves touring the world with a band. But then the reality of it is pretty dull unless you go looking for things of interest, which tends to involve food related things and going out for dinner or sightseeing or finding other activities. And unfortunately, a lot of the people on the tour campaign are of a similar mindset where they like to do that kind of thing as well. And so it makes for a very fulfilling trip, you know.
I think what a lot of amateur, in inverted commas in that, but amateur bands would do in that situation would also be like, okay, we've got time to kill, let's go to the pub. And
yes,
that completely impacts your performance later on in the day.
Absolutely.
Right? Then all of a sudden you've realised you've had 4 pints and you've got to play a gig tonight, and
yeah,
you think you're more confident than you actually are, and the ability levels diminish perhaps.
No, of course. And I think that's probably more prevalent in younger bands. And I'm lucky that I joined the live tour with the 1975 when I was 24, 25, which is still obviously at an age where you're going to go out and do silly things. But I was still responsible enough to really, I think, just to really understand how amazing the opportunity was. And the last thing I wanted to do was to jeopardize that. And this may sound quite nerdy, but I enjoy sound checks because I just love playing, generally speaking. And I quite like being in an empty venue through the day. It has quite an interesting atmosphere. And I don't mind having to do that at all. I actually look forward to it. I'd much rather sound check than not.
See, if you could have the perfect sound check so you feel completely ready and happy, and like, wow, that everything's in its place, as you walk off stage for the sound check, what does that look like? What are the things you most need in your monitors? Or, and is it really different sound checking to an empty room? to what it actually ends up sounding like on stage.
Because yeah.
So does it almost, not like it's pointless, but it's like, do you, in the back of your mind, do you think, well, it's not going to sound like this anyway?
You know, the sound engineers that have worked with the band over time and people who are working at that level, they know how to make adjustments between soundcheck and the live and the evening performance to make things sound good, because through the day there's so much more reflectivity, there's not as much to absorb the sound, whereas when you have 15,000 people there, it changes things dramatically. With the nature of the 1975 gig, we don't have any live backline on stage. It's all in our in-ears, and any amps are off stage, or they're what they're called, campers. It's basically a digital amplifier. Like it emulates different.
Right.
I mean, if any guitarists who might be listening to this will might find that a bit embarrassing, that my description. But but long story short, there's not a lot of live sound on stage. So the only live sounds are George's drums, my saxophone, and then Maddie's vocals. And so it isn't a very live sounding stage. It's quite quiet on stage. And so we're very dependent on what we hear in our ears. And so I suppose just being really comfortable with the sound that's coming into our ears is kind of crucial. But we're fortunate that with everything being digital and everything's very consistent night to night, and perhaps because it's a quiet stage, maybe it's easier to do that over the course of a tour, to keep things pretty consistent night to night.
What do you want on, so I guess your sound, you know, what you have in your ears is going to be different mm-hmm. to what the other members of the band yeah. have. So what's your preference? Do you want a lot of the snare drum?
I want it to sound like a live stage. I want to hear a fair balance of everyone and okay. everything. And so Jamie Squire, he was the other session musician who works with the band. He's just particularly gifted at, was very expressively accompanying people. He never overplays. He's very understated. There's a song called If I Believe You. In the outro of that, there's a fair amount of wiggle room for all of us to just embellish parts subtly. And I like having plenty of Jamie in there, because I can bounce off some of his ideas. I don't just want a ton of saxophone and ignore everything else. I like it to feel the way that it used to sound playing in smaller venues where you've got a live room. And I like having a lot of the audience in my ears as well. There's microphones that are pointed out towards the crowd. And I want to really hear and feel the atmosphere in the room, because with in-ear monitoring, it can feel very isolated.
Has there ever been an issue where you haven't been able to hear your saxophone?
Yeah.
And can you pitch? Like, how difficult is it to pitch with a saxophone? Is that a complete nightmare situation?
It's not a complete nightmare situation, because the mouthpiece is literally between your teeth. The pitch that you're playing at, it physically resonates
in your brain.
Yeah. And it's a similar sensation to if you were to speak and then put your fingers in your ears, you can hear yourself quite loud. And so with in-ear monitoring, it kind of amplifies the acoustic sound without it being played through the in-ear, you know what I mean? So, but there was one occasion, it was a long time ago, it was on the first album campaign. We were playing at a festival, and I think it was in Holland. And I can't remember the name of the festival, but a fairly, a sizable festival crowd on a main stage. And I walked out to play a solo, and I started playing, and there was nothing going on, but I could still hear everyone else. And I think my channel was just muted for whatever reason. And then it came in like blaringly loud midway through. And so that's happened once before. And, or maybe like the battery pack on my mic or something is gone as I walk out on stage, and a tech has to run out with batteries and put the pack in, and it's just little silly things like that happen maybe once in a blue moon.
So that brings me on to, I know you played a very prominent role in Sam Fender's quite a hit record. It went to number one, so Hypersonic Missiles, and you play on the opening track of that, which was, a big single. And actually, I don't know if I've told you this story, but you and I were due to do a run down the Thames. I can't remember when it was, like maybe 18 months ago, and last minute you couldn't make it. And so I ended up listening to this podcast where this guy was talking about all the new music that was coming out, and I run down the Thames and he mentioned this Hypersonic Missiles, and I was like, I'm sure John's on this. And then it's like nothing. And then, like, you come screaming in at, like, the last minute and a half of that song. And I was like, oh, John did make it for the run, which is awesome. Yeah. Tell us about when you have played with him live, which I think has only been a couple of times. I think you're on the same bill in Japan. How easy is it for you just to, like, just rock up and play that part? And did you rehearse? And are there technicalities with them, the engineers and stuff, that you need to kind of really iron out beforehand with just walking onto a big show with someone else?
And so, yeah, so I've only played with Sam once.
Right.
And like you mentioned, it was by chance that he was playing on the same bill as the 1975 at Summer Sonic Festival in Japan. And so we didn't really have any time to rehearse other than to play it acoustically in a dressing room. And from the, given the nature of that solo, you can't really play it quietly because it's like this Clarence Clemens, Bruce Springsteen kind of Americana, gravelly saxophone solo, very high. And so most of the, you know, rehearsal, if we can call it that, was more just discussion based beforehand. And the nice thing about the any technical aspect about that gig and about Sam and the way he plays live is that it's a very live stage, so it's a very different environment on stage to the 1975. There's a lot of backline. There's no track which corresponds to live production and video and lights and everything. It's a very, I don't want to use the word old school, but it's just a very different way of performing live. And so the idea of adding a musician into that is actually pretty simple, and there's next to no stress involved. And so I imagine for any, regardless of their experience, any sound engineer to add another microphone and that I can, and yeah, then that was it.
And how did you hear yourself? Was there in-ear monitors or were you?
No, I don't think we had any in-ears. I just had some wedges on the floor.
Oh, fine.
And plus it was like, I was playing, I think I played on two tunes. So we played,
You're Not the Only One. Is that the other one you
want? We didn't actually play that live. It was The Borders.
Right. Okay.
So that this a tune which features saxophone, but it was Johnny Blue Hat Davis, and that's his name. He played on that tune, and he's the guy who now plays in the band. And so I suppose the only real stress for me would be learning that solo in the dressing room, but it was just fun and relaxed and it, in a really good way. Everything was loose, and it felt like playing in a bar when we weren't at all. It was this huge festival crowd in Summer Sonic Festival. And so it was fun. It was great.
Can you tell us about actually recording that track? So that was obviously, as I say, quite a big hit. Did Sam kind of write the part that you'll give you a guide about what you wanted? Was it a guitar part you were tracking, or was it just a case that do whatever you want?
Yeah, no, he had a very clear idea of what he wanted. And it's basically, for the main body of the solo in that bridge section, is just three notes. But it's all about the delivery and the tone of it, and the sort of Bruce Springsteen and Clarence Clemens influence. Because I think to any music lover, if you say Clarence Clemens and Bruce Springsteen, you can kind of hear and see what that music is. You know what I mean? It's a very, this very clear East Coast grit, Americana sound. And so it was a very straightforward session. Sam was basically singing me the solo.
Nice.
And then we did just a handful of different takes, and then, but then it evolved. The outro of that opens up a little bit more for the saxophone part, and there's that kind of screaming. It's a, on tenor saxophone, it's like a high C sharp in the altissimo register. So that just basically means high note for any, you know, in layman's terms. And it was quite fun to have the freedom to do that. Sam was pretty open about how I could approach that, and he basically said, well, if you can get that note, then just give it a shot. And then he really liked it. And just whilst we're on the topic, I'm so excited and so proud to have played on that album. And not just because it's a brilliant album and it did really well and was well received, but I met Sam through his older brother, Liam. I used to play in a band with Liam in Newcastle, in like a funk and soul band. And Sam came round when he was maybe 18 years old to my flat in Jesmond at the time to show me some demos and wanted me to add some saxophone parts to them. And it was, and I think at the time he had just met his manager and they had, like, you know, a plan that they were going to try and follow through with and had these great ideas. And then it was maybe 4 years later, I suppose, maybe 3 or 4 years later, is when by that stage Sam had released a couple of EPs and then was at the stage to write an album and had gained a little bit of notoriety and airplay on Radio 1. And so he went from being this very, when he was younger, when I first met him, this incredibly enthusiastic, but almost like he had this sort of nervous energy about him because he was a teenage boy, really. Like, you know, but he was exceptionally talented, and he's always had that, the voice that he has, with this huge projection. And I just love that he was given an opportunity, and just see, it seemed to grow very organically. It kind of just, everything came out of him very naturally. And it's quite a rarity. I think, you know, anyone who's worked around Sam has been able to kind of, you know, contribute in their way, but it's always Sam's been able to carry himself very well, I think. And to know that John Davis, is now his saxophone player is great, because we used to play in a youth band together, the Northumberland County Youth Jazz Orchestra, and he's 2 or 3 years older than me, and I've always looked up to him. And so when I was in my early teens, I just thought he was this amazing. He's always had a great tone as well, amazing saxophone player, and so he's the perfect guy for Sam's band, and I'm very proud to have contributed to the album. But I think it was always going to be John's gig live.
And he must play that part that you,
yeah,
live, right? So yeah. Have you ever seen him play that? Like, that must be such a real thing, actually.
Yeah, it's great, and he absolutely nails it. He's an amazing saxophone player, and he certainly had, there are certain qualities in his playing that I don't have, and so I love watching him play. I love hearing him play.
So last time we had you on the podcast, John, you'd recorded and released an EP called Flight, which was great, and we've been waiting so long for this new EP to come out, which came out recently, which has three tracks on there called Signal Hill, Luca and Edwin. And it's beautiful. It came out a couple of months ago, I think. Tell us about, firstly, why it took so long to release. Because each time I spoke to you, like, yeah, it's coming. Was that through distractions, or was it piecing it together? Tell us about how that's come about. And I'd like to delve into the particular song Edwin, which is my favourite track of the three, which I believe is about your grandfather.
Yes.
And just the use of strings on that song and the second track as well is just so beautiful. Mm-hmm. So tell us about the evolution of that recording.
Yeah. Well, it's not that I really started writing this EP in, when it would have been the beginning of 2018, I suppose. I started just writing music then, and that was because I'd just moved to London at the time, and knew that I wouldn't be touring for a year, and so at the time I thought I wouldn't have distractions, but then of course there always are. And at first I was writing music that wasn't really band orientated or groove based. I was trying to write music that was influenced by Nils Fromm and Oliver Arnolds, these, you know, people who I suppose bridge the gap between almost like contemporary classical music combined with electronic ambience and that type of thing. And as much as I really loved doing it, it didn't really feel very authentic, and it wasn't really me. And it's not that I've completely abandoned those ideas. I still have them, and there's a couple of things that I will continue working on them. But a couple of the tunes that I felt more comfortable with have appeared on this EP. So Luca and Edwin were both written back then, or at least I'd started working on them. And then due to just a number of distractions and just prioritizing other work, I had to just slowly chip away at the, you know, at just recording them. And because I don't have, you know, any representation or label or funding coming from anyone else, it's all been managed by me. And I think that's probably why it's taken so long to finish. And I didn't just want to find a nice synth string pad for those string arrangements. I wanted to record them live and you know, dedicate a lot of time to making them sound good. And so I was able to get together with my friends Jessica and David to work on those, and then also a friend of mine, Neil Harland, up in Newcastle, who was playing upright. And yeah, I suppose if I'm going to put music out, I want to make sure that I'm doing it to the best of my ability, and I want it to sound great. So it just takes time to do that.
It's difficult to not have a deadline, right?
And it is, yes.
As a perfectionist, you're like, oh, each time you listen to it, you think, I could tweak that a little bit.
Absolutely. And so I think it would probably serve me very well to have someone to tell me that, you know, enough is enough. But then the good thing is about the people that I was working with, they're exceptionally talented. And so, for example, the bassist, Neil Harland, who was playing upright, and then I think he was playing might have played bowed upright on a couple, on one of the tunes, I can't remember now, but I gave him some handwritten chord progressions, and that was all I gave him, and I sent him a very early demo of the tunes, and then the music that he sends back is just so expressive and amazing, and the way in which he can capture his own tone is exceptional. And so the thing that speeds up the process, I suppose, is that, you know, I'm dependent on brilliant musicians, and that takes a lot of the work out of my hands. And so I suppose the collaborative aspect of things has been really good fun on working on this album, because it required a lot of people's input and time and care. And I think that you can hear that in the, not with regards to the composition, but the quality of the sound, I think, is due to the, you know, the quality of the musicianship.
Yeah, I mean, the strings coming was such a joy to hear halfway through the record and through to the third track, to Edwin. So tell us about Edwin. Tell us about your grandfather and why you named the song Edwin.
I think at first I had part of, even just a fragment of the song demoed on piano, and just had those, some of the chords and the harmony recorded. And it already had a very sort of gentry, old-fashioned kind of charming quality to it. And it was something that my mum said, and it, so Edwin was my dad's father, but it was something that my mum had said about Edwin, my grandfather. She said that he was the epitome of a gentleman, and we both started talking about how he was particularly softly spoken, despite being, he was like, I think 6'4", like particularly broad shoulders, and has these huge, like both him and my dad have got these huge hands, and so, and when they walk into a room, you can't help but, you know, they can command a room very easily. And but the thing that I loved about my granddad is that he was, I can still remember the tone of his voice quite vividly. He was very softly spoken, and I really like that quality in people. He didn't have to say anything to command a room, or to, you know, you would respect him based on just how his demeanor was. He didn't have to say anything, which is lovely. And so I tried to instill that in the music with these very lush, broad arrangements with chord voicings played by the strings and saxes. And but then there's moments of silence between some of the sections. And so it's quite a dynamic piece of music. And I think that shows the kind of the broader picture of his character traits, I suppose.
It's a beautiful piece of music and a great tribute to him. And you also played on a record called, you played on a few tracks with Pliny, is that right?
Yes.
Yeah, as well. Now, I'm interested, because they're instrumentals, and I'm interested in, you know, if you're writing instrumental music, which you do, and you've got a fixed idea about, you know, this is what this song is about. You know, there's no lyrics, but this is what this song is about. Would Pliny kind of give you a heads up about that, or was it just an open space where you could do what you wanted to?
Yeah, there was no. I think the first tune that I played on is it's entitled Flaneur. I think I'm pronouncing it right, which I think it's French for if you were to wander aimlessly around a city and just to explore somewhere and just walk around without any specific aim or idea. Then that's the term.
Nice.
And so I knew about that beforehand, but then I think, it, like you said, it's quite hard to convey that because it's such an interpretive thing. And then with the more recent tune that I played on, which is called Pan, I didn't know what the title was before I played on it, and so I was going purely based on what was already on the demo at the time. So everything was just musically driven in a more technical way, I suppose. But the nice thing about working with Pliny is that he's always given me a lot of freedom with the solos that I've recorded with him. He doesn't really, you know, he doesn't really set any parameters at all. He just trusts the people that he collaborates with. And I suppose particularly with Pan, I loved working on that solo, and I spent quite a lot of time on it. I think it wasn't a case of just sitting down and working on it over the course of a couple of hours or improvising one or two takes. I think I spent about a week refining it and I don't want to spoil the magic, but overdubbing a fair amount to get things just right. And I think it's because it was such a good opportunity for me to play something which is quite far removed from a lot of the pop session work that I've done. And I suppose because when you do, especially with pop saxophone, and I think because I've played with the 1975, there are a lot of bands who get in touch and kind of say, or they don't even have to say anything, they'll send through a very 80s inspired demo, and it's in the key of D or what, and it's, And it's, you know, and that's great. It's not that that's a bad thing, but it's always very easy to play over those. Well, actually, I tell you what, no, it's challenging because I don't want to repeat myself.
Yeah.
But with Pan, well, with both tunes, with Flaneur and Pan, there was a lot of freedom in what I could do. And there was very much a blank canvas. And I felt like I could, I suppose, channel a lot of the influences that I have that I don't really get the opportunity to channel when I'm working in a pop environment. So some of the stuff I'm playing is very jazz influenced and bebop inspired.
And I don't know, you won't expect, you're probably not expecting me to say this, but when I listened to the Pliny recordings that you did, like, you've got a very definitive style, because I knew, like, it sounded like you. It's like, that's so obviously John.
Right.
Right. Is that something you go for? Like,
absolutely. I would love, you know, so, well, thank you very much, because what I would love is for there to be a common thread between everything that I do.
And there is. Right. I honestly think, so far listening to you, all the stuff you played, like, right, immediately it was like, oh, that wasn't some other sax player. It was like, oh, wow, that's so John. Right.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, it's very noticeable that it was you. Yeah. And I'm not, like, an aficionado, like, listening to saxophone players, so I wondered whether that's coincidence, but it's probably a case that you've actually got a particular style.
All right.
Your definitive kind of sound that you have as a player, and the words I'd used, or I would use, are refrained and kind of breathy.
Mm-hmm.
Does that sound about right to you, or what are you looking to go for?
Yeah, I think that's what I'd, you know, in an ideal musical scenario, if I can use those, or lean towards those quality of tones, then yeah, that would be right up my street. And I think that's the breathiness comes from listening to saxophone players like Paul Desmond and Stan Getz, and so they were part of the West Coast cool era in jazz music, and would play very sort of, they would really hold back with regards to their, I don't know, melodic decisions, and very understated. And though when you look at the work that I do now, a lot of the kind of sound that is required is more bright with a lot of projection, and so I suppose I sort of I have the means to do both, but within, if I'm in my comfort zone, I kind of fall right in the middle, I suppose. And so with the Pliny tune Pan, I get to explore both extremes of that. So at the very beginning of that solo, it's, you know, very held back with a lot of space and an emphasis on the tail end of those notes, and all of the breathiness comes out, and I'm, you know, wanting to really capitalize on that. But then towards the end, it's like a screaming solo with a lot of projection, and, you know, and so I think that's why I wanted to spend so much time on it. It's just to try and explore those two extremes.
And regular listeners of the podcast will know that for a while, I had to pause at the moment because we had a baby, but we run a business, myself and my partner, called StageLeft Nights, where we have musicians play in our lounge. And my partner's very lucky. She's an award-winning chef. So she does a 5-course meal, and you sit and eat with a guest who is a musician, a well-known musician. John, you came to the first one, and then you played a latter one. Mm. We also had Mo Pleasure do one as well, and she drew the gun. And I remember you saying that you shared that you were, maybe nervous is a strong word, but you were more aware and maybe a little bit nervous, apprehensive about playing that, because you were only playing to 8 people in our lounge. That was the first thing that was really interesting that struck me. So what were the what's the root cause of those nerves? Is it the proximity? Is it the scrutiny? And also, I was really fascinated that we were a bit worried that it was going to piss off the neighbours, because obviously saxophone is quite a loud instrument, and you were just like, no, it's fine, I'll just play quieter. So just talk us through those two things, how easy it is to play quieter, and why nervousness in such an intimate setting.
Well, yeah, I think it's the intimacy of those environments that I find quite nerve-wracking, and because you can't hide, really. And it's not that you can hide on stage in an arena, but I think if you're part of a big production, then you feel like you're a smaller part of the whole thing. And whereas smaller intimate performances, I love doing them, but I naturally just feel a little bit more nervous about them because of that, the degree of intimacy there. And I certainly wouldn't say scrutiny. I think on that evening it was a particularly lovely audience of people, and so they were very kind. But and I think with regards to playing quietly, it's a challenge because you might lose certain qualities in the sound.
Really,
right. I suppose. But I love playing quietly. I don't mind it at all, because it just, even if you may lose certain things, there are certain things that you do gain as a result of it, and you know.
Now we are doing something new on the StageLeft podcast. Not only have we got John back for a second time, which is the first time we've done it. But we're also given an opportunity for, if you're a listener and you're in a band that's up and coming, doing your own thing, or a solo artist, you can ask our guests some questions. And so we've got Billy Exton, who has recorded three questions that we're going to play now. John's going to go through one by one. Billy is a saxophone player from Australia, and we're going to hand over to Billy now for his first question.
G'day, John. My name's Billy. I'm a saxophone player from Australia. Awesome to hear about your work with the 1975, and I would like to ask, what do you think is next for the saxophone in popular music? Do you think we're due for an evolution, a revolution, or reverting all the way back to the classic pop sax of the 80s? Which direction do you think it's going in, and why?
Well, I think probably, and I hope, an evolution. And I think that reverting back to the 80s inspired thing has already been done with bands like M83, The Midnight, and perhaps the 1975, I suppose. But there are really amazing examples of the saxophone being used in a way which completely breaks down any parameters that would surround the 80s thing. And especially if you were to check out, there's a saxophone player called Mike Lewis, who I absolutely love, and he plays in Bon Iver. And there's a moment on the Live at the Sydney Opera House gig, I think he's playing on the tune Michikant, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, and the solo that he does, and the aspects of playing that we were talking about a moment ago with regards to tone and breathiness, and you can tell that he's very focused on the quality of his sound because he has so much space in his playing, and so you can't help but notice the breathy quality to everything, but also his creative decisions and note choices. And he doesn't champion the 80s inspired saxophone playing. He's far more jazz influenced, but when you listen to him, it's not as if he's taking the audience to jazz land. He's very in keeping with the Bon Iver kind of sound, and I think it's quite a rarity these days, and it's certainly something that I try to emulate if I'm given the right kind of opportunity. And so I think, given how big artists like Bon Iver are, I think hopefully we'll see an evolution where the use of saxophone will be far more than just like the fun 80s kind of solo over the bridge section thing.
Cool, let's hear Billy's next question.
How much do you reckon jazz chops are important for a pop sax player? Do you reckon a pop sax player needs all the chops of a jazz musician, or is it a different skill set?
I think it's not necessary in the slightest, and I think they're very different skill sets. And I think I've always tried to just serve the music and really listen the best I can. The last thing that I want to do is shoehorn in a ton of jazz licks to serve my own ego. I think it's far more important to really listen to the music you're playing over and I suppose serve the vision of the artist that you're playing with. And so I suppose sometimes maybe there's an advantage that if you've really applied yourself within the jazz world, maybe your technique is particularly good, and so it's easier to then dial things back a little bit, rather than if you're suddenly thrown into a position where you have to try and, pull out the big guns, but you don't have the means to do that. But I think that's, that's quite a hypothetical situation. Yeah.
What sort of gear are you rocking? And do you think it makes that much difference? Would you encourage a sax player to put an emphasis on their gear, or just forget about it and play to the music?
I think with the saxophone, from my own experience, any time that I've upgraded something, it's not that it suddenly makes me into a better saxophone player. It doesn't really contribute to a better sound. But what it does do is it improves the way in which it feels to interact with the instrument. So I play, I think it's a 1972 Selmer Mark VI. And certainly when I first got that, I was more inspired to play because it was such a comfortable instrument to play, and the ergonomics of the design and how everything felt under my hands was so good. But that doesn't mean that it's going to generate new ideas. You still have to explore that over time, and you find that through doing the work, the groundwork, and you know, checking out other musicians. And but yeah, I think that moment of inspiration when you get a new instrument fades if you're not doing the work properly.
So thank you to Billy Exton. He's on Instagram. Go and find him out. He's doing some really cool stuff with the sax. And if you do want to send questions in, we're going to start doing this. They've got to be good questions like Billy's, though. Not like when you're next playing the current city that I happen to be living in, which is the ones we normally get. So, yeah, do just get in touch with us on the StageLeft podcast on Instagram. Send me a DM or on Twitter at the StageLeft pod or facebook.com/ the StageLeft podcast. So I was watching a documentary last night on the boxer, Tyson Fury, and he had this thing where he was struggling to book a holiday online with the passports of his kids, because three of his kids are all called Prince, right? Mm-hmm. And the opening track of every 1975 record is called the 1975, right?
Yeah.
Right. How do you guys differentiate between which one you're referring to if it's all called the same? Is that not a nightmare? It's a nightmare for everyone else.
Well, I don't think so. I think maybe as the as a new tour campaign starts or a new album comes out, you'd refer to that 1975 track as the one that's current, I suppose. And then more recently with the collaboration with Greta Thunberg, that her speech has become the more recent, the 1975 tune, and it kind of breaks the mold of the use of the lyrics that were used in the previous versions. So no, not really. No.
It's just never a problem. So you always know, you're always on.
Yeah, time. And it hasn't ever really been much of a topic of conversation, I suppose.
It's really powerful at your show at the O2 how you didn't have an encore. Like, the band did go off stage, but Matty stayed on stage, mm-hmm. and Greta Thunberg's kind of...
Mm.
It's not a poem, I don't know, it's like a call to arms, really, isn't
yeah.
it? Over a beautiful piece of music. And it's really powerful, and you mm-hmm. know, a lot of solidarity in the crowd and that kind of thing. It really felt like an important moment, actually. It was really, yeah, quite a profound thing to, because the seats we had, we just saw this kind of sea of people below who were just kind of all very much living this message, and it was very, very powerful, and a great use of that time to have a break off stage rather than just kind of leaving the crowd doing nothing but listening to a really well put together argument. Because I really like about that kind of that call to arms is that she kind of explains what the issue is, mm. why it's a problem, but then says the how. It's like, okay, this is how we can go mm-hmm. about changing things. Mm-hmm. And I just think it's really, really well put together. If you were to think about the time that you guys have been laughing on stage because something's happened, mm. what gig was it? What had happened?
We had a gig on Halloween in Pittsburgh a few years ago, and the band decided to do a Star Wars themed gig. And it's not that we just wore outfits, they adapted their production to have these, I suppose, interludes where they played the theme music, and they added just very, very simple and fun elements of theatre into it. So like, our security guy was dressed as Mark was dressed as Darth Vader, so he came on and handed Matty his guitar whilst they played like the Vader theme and nice. Stuff like that. And half of the crew were Ewoks and the other half were stormtroopers in, like, you know, full suit helmets and things. And somehow I was encouraged to dress up as Princess Leia.
Really?
And so I played, for the first few tunes, I was in like the white gown.
No way.
And then to come out and play the solo and heart out, I was in the, what I think has been coined in the film, not by us, but in the film, the slave bikini. We tried it because I had to do, quote unquote, a costume change before that. And then we tried to do it in soundcheck, but I couldn't physically play because it was just so funny and it was so embarrassing. And like, no one wants to see me dressed in that. And that was obviously the gag, really. It was just so hilarious. And so when it came to the gig, I think Matty just fell to the floor because he couldn't contain himself, and I had to keep playing. And I can tell you, it is so hard to play a saxophone when all you want to do is laugh hysterically. So that was probably a highlight, I suppose. But even just through the day when we were doing soundcheck, seeing Ross dressed as Chewbacca, he was just sitting down between songs, and just seeing him sit with his bass just in front of him, just like sitting normally, it was just so funny because it was such a candid little moment.
Yeah,
and just silly things like that were just, it was so much fun. And it came, midway through a particularly long tour, and it really lifted everyone's spirits, and you know, it was so much fun. It was great.
Amazing. And did you break the hydraulic system on the stage in Vegas?
Yes, that's right. So I think it's the Cosmopolitan Hotel. It has a theater inside, and I think from what I've gathered is to separate all of the vibration and the resonance between the venue and the hotel rooms that are part of the same building that have this hydraulic system. And so I don't know too much about it, but the entire stage, and I think a lot of the floor, is on this enormous hydraulic thing. And so you can physically feel the stage move up and down as the crowd jumps up and down.
That's weird.
It's bizarre. And at the end of there's a song called The Sound where Matty makes the crowd very willingly jump up and down, and it broke the hydraulic system in this building. But it was very strange. It was like almost like being on like a wave or some kind of bouncy castle or something on stage. And
the visuals were absolutely stunning when I saw you guys. Like, it is an incredible like production. With big shows with the 1975, like, do you have to rehearse a lot to that production beforehand? And even you individually, like, do you have to, you know, are you just hiring like a massive venue and just doing rehearsals before the tour?
There's a couple of different locations where we rehearse in a huge warehouse. There are a handful of them in the UK that are purposely for people to rehearse these large productions. And so we'd rehearse as a band in just a regular rehearsal room for a few weeks. And I suppose during that time, the crew are really practicing how to build the set, because there are so many moving parts to it now. They were part of the production that we just had these three cuboids that had screens on every surface, and they move up and down and rotate. And then there were these three, like the logo for the band, the box.
Yeah,
I think there was three of those and a huge back screen, and so all of that obviously has to be built every day and then torn down and then put into trucks and then it goes off to the next venue. And so one of the three cuboids, which has the video walls on them, I can remember speaking to one of the guys in the crew, and they had, I think it was 2 weeks before the first UK date, they were able to build one of those cubes in 12 hours, and they had to figure out how to do it in three. And so whilst we're just focusing on playing our instruments and playing the music, there's about 30 guys who are, you know, trying to solve all these problems and work against time, and you know, there's so much that goes into it. And so anyway, yes, once that's taken care of, we can go into the production rehearsals where we don't really need to rehearse the music anymore, but we're there to make sure that the music can coexist with the production seamlessly. Yeah, so there was a lot of time that went into that.
There was this visual kind of, not gag, but this visual event that took place, probably my favourite 1975 song, it's called Lost My Head. Mm. And Matty kind of goes into the screen and it looks like he's been kind of sucked into the screen.
Yeah.
It's such an impressive, like, you know, it's a production. It's just, it's incredible. So if anyone gets a chance to see 1975 live, you know, as well as the music, you're going to really enjoy kind of what you're seeing in front of you. Tell us about the sessions you did with Bob Reynolds that ended up at 1975 Records, because Bob Reynolds is someone who came on the podcast a couple of years ago. You booked him for us, which is very kind of you, and put us in touch. A legendary sax player with John Mayer, as well as many other people. And he ended up playing with you, is that right?
Yeah.
On 1975 Records. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so Mighty gave me the task of putting together a horn section for a session whilst we were in Los Angeles. And so this was a session that was for the Notes on a Conditional Form album. And so we were on tour at the time, and we were in South America. We had a handful of dates there. Then we were going to LA, and the band had a studio booked for 2 weeks. And I think whilst we were there, we had a couple of other gigs in some of the, not, I suppose you wouldn't call them neighboring cities in California, because they're still very far away, but we were based in LA for 2 weeks, basically. And so I had maybe a month to try and, which is plenty of time to get a horn section together for the section. And so the first person I called was Bob, And I kind of said, you know, I'd love to have you on board. And also, if you can recommend any guys to come down. And it just so happened that he recommended Rashawn Ross. He was one of my favorite horn players of all time. And Rashawn plays with like the Dave Matthews Band. And then he's like one of the leading session musicians in LA. But I saw him play at first with the Dave Matthews Band. And then through those guys, I found Lamar Jewelry, trombone player, who at the time was playing with Kanye West at the Sunday service at Coachella. And so basically three heavyweight session musicians, all of whom I greatly admire. And it was my job to hand them the sheet music that I had written out. But it was just, it was a breeze, and it was one of the most fulfilling days' work I've ever done. And to them, it was, you know, another day at work. And I'm sure, I had heard from Bob a couple of years before, because he'd heard the 1975 song, The Sound, mm-hmm. a lot whilst he was driving, I think, and he tweeted me about it saying he thought it was just really great. And so I knew that the band were on his radar and that he knew that I was playing with them. And so I knew that Bob would have been, I'm sure, interested to play and to do the session. But for me, it was like this dream opportunity. And to play alongside those guys. And there was, what we did is we recorded live as a section and then recorded individually and then paired off. And so I got to play in unison with Bob and then in harmony with him and hear him in like a, you know, really good conditioned room and hear his tone and everything that I've tried to emulate in my own playing, but just 2 feet away from me. And it's amazing because even the simplest of melodies suddenly becomes the hardest thing to play, because you just focus so heavily on the smaller details and fundamental things like tuning, and the last thing you want to do is make a silly mistake in front of your heroes.
And what was that used on? Can you answer that question?
Oh yeah, they're in the horn section. In If You're Too Shy, Let Me Know.
Oh, is that right?
And, okay, yeah, awesome. And I think we played on Birthday Party. I think it's called Tonight I Wish I Was Your Boy. So a handful of tunes. And I think they captured some kind of ambient breathy noises for Having No Head as well. But they're so subtle that you'd never know that they were horns. But it was absolutely incredible. It was absolutely amazing.
And you just mentioned If You're Too Shy there, where you're kind of very much front and centre throughout that song, which is amazing. And it was a big single as well from 1975. And the video, you were telling me earlier, that video is, the sound quality is obviously so amazing from it, because it's actually a live version of it.
Yeah.
And I didn't even realise, I thought it had been overdubbed like they normally do music videos to the original. So you actually did that in live, and how challenging was that? Was that, you know, to get all the sound right and the movements? And,
yeah. I think because of the way in which the band play live, and there's very little live backline, it's easy for it to be consistent regardless of where you're playing. And also we had just finished a UK tour playing that material. So it was all very fresh and, you know, straightforward. But because you're on like a film set, it's a very sterile environment and there's no PA, so the only audible sound is coming through our ears. And so you could hear my saxophone and George's drums, but then if you were like, you know, a camera, if you were part of the crew that were filming, you wouldn't really hear a fair representation of the performance until you hear the audio at a later date. So when you have that in the back of your mind as you're performing, you just feel a little bit silly because you're just playing very loud and exposed saxophone and no one can hear the context apart from the guys in the band. So I suppose that's a little challenge, but like I said, we'd just done a tour, so it was pretty straightforward.
Just really nailed it. So how has, you know, the pandemic, you know, impacted you? You know, it's affected so many musicians. I know in that time you've tried to keep yourself busy by doing some teaching.
Yeah.
So you offer one-to-one tutorials, and also you released a book. Yeah, which is a great book. You know, you can tell us about the book and tell us about how the teaching's going, and just generally your views on how, you know, musicians have been impacted by the pandemic.
Well, something that I've found, it's been particularly challenging, and I think every musician that I know really lives and breathes music, and so when you're deprived of your calling as a person and you're deprived of your, not just your main source of income, but the thing that you dedicate so much time and care to, it obviously has a significant effect on your mental well-being and just how you structure your day-to-day life. So it has been particularly challenging, and I think in the scheme of things I've been fortunate, because I know a handful of people who have like lost their house and,
really?
You know, have had to uproot their life and rethink everything and had to find employment from things in places that have no musical connection at all. Yeah. Whereas, thankfully, I had the teaching, and it's music education has always been it's been a mainstay in my career, and it was a mainstay in my childhood as well. So it was an easy transition for me to make because I knew that I had that, and it wasn't something to fall back on because I've always done it. It's just always been there, and it just took a little bit of an adaptation to be able to do that over Zoom and, you know, video call. And I suppose with that being the emphasis of my work over the COVID thing, that very naturally led into me making this book. And I'd never really considered making a book before, but I can remember watching an interview between two bass players that I really admire, Victor Wooten and Yannick Guzdala. And they're both brilliant examples of not just insanely gifted musicians, but people who are very prevalent in music education and have published and self-published a lot of material and books themselves. And there's just this really lovely, very candid conversation between the two of them, having a very similar conversation like this about the COVID thing and how musicians are adapting. And they start talking about their books, and it's such a casual conversation, and it seems like it's such a natural extension to the work that they do as a musician. And I thought, right, well, at the minute I'm teaching a lot, and I find that I'm repeating myself a lot. A lot of people are asking me the same questions. And so it was very easy for me to sort of log things in my mind, and everything's very much at the forefront of my mind constantly, and I could just rattle off these answers, not without being sincere or anything, but, you know. And so I just started writing it down in the notes on my phone. That's how it started. I just kind of thought, right, well, if I was going to make a book, how would I structure it? And so I just broke it down into 7 or 8 chapters or sections, and then began elaborating on that. And then once I started, it just became one of the most immersive projects I've ever done. And I'm not a writer by any means. I'm not very articulate or anything. But I think just because of the experience of teaching for the past 10 years, and also having really good working relationships with my teachers when I was younger, I think I was able to hone the way in which I communicate things, musically speaking. And so I became quite obsessive with it. I would wake up and maybe start at around 8:30, and sometimes not finish working until 9 p.m. And I've never done that with anything. I've never been so immersed in a project before. Even EPs or sessions, whatever it is, I couldn't switch off from the book until I finished it.
Where can people buy it?
So it's available via my website. And so the physical copies come direct from me, but that's just within the UK. But then for anyone overseas, it's on Amazon, and you can download an ebook copy as well. And it's essentially a guide, an entry-level guide to improvisation. It's called Jazz Improvisation Basic Training.
And do you have to be a sax player?
No. It's written in the treble clef, so bass players would just have to, or anyone who reads bass clef will have to bear that in mind. And I suppose it outlines the fundamentals that you need to have in your playing to be able to play freely. And that's something that I try to emphasize a lot in the book, is that you don't need to know all of the theory under the sun to be a good jazz improviser. You just don't. You can cherry pick the things that move you as a listener. And that, I think that's key as well, is being moved by the things that you're working on. But then having said that as well, there is a misconception in that if you're studying a lot of theory, then the music that you play is going to be sterile or, you know, which just isn't the case, because I think it depends on how you practice it. And so if you're doing the groundwork and if you practice things effectively, the more that you delve into some of this theory, that it kind of frees you up further. It is, you know, at face value, it's a textbook, really. It's very black and white. And if you were to open a page at random, you'd be like, well, what the fuck is this? I'm not going to read this. I just want to play blues music, or I want to play heavy metal, or whatever it is. But then you just have to trust me that if you sit down and practice some of the stuff that's in the book for 10 minutes a day, and then go off and do whatever it is that you want to play for fun. When you practice things at a fundamental level, it has a huge positive influence on your playing. And so that's what I've tried to cover in the book.
From the last 4 years, because we asked you this question last time, which gig have you played that you'd most like to have been in the audience for?
Maybe Madison Square Garden?
Or what was so special about Madison Square Garden? Or was that a stupid question?
No, it's not. It's not a stupid question. It's, but then it's an obvious question, but things are obvious for a reason. And I think even if I wasn't into a band, to see them play at Madison Square Garden for the first time would still be a spectacle, because even if you play something note for note the same way as you did the previous night, it's still going to feel different and you're going to be thinking differently. And I think in that environment, it's not just Madison Square Garden. There's something about New York as well. When you play there, it's always like a highlight of a tour. You get excited to play. I mean, I get excited to play all of them, but when you're in New York especially, everything just feels different and better. And Madison Square Garden, because of the history associated to it and not just the bands, but the sporting events that have happened there, you can't help but feel connected to all of that. And I suppose it makes you feel you have a stronger connection to the people that you greatly admire, because you think, right, well, Jesus, they've been here and they were admired because they were here, and now I'm somehow here, and it's bizarre. And then it's such a tangible thing as well. It's incredible. So I'd love to be able to witness that from the audience. It would be an amazing perspective.
Stealing one of Billy's other questions, actually, that we didn't hear from earlier, because I think it's a really nice one to finish on, is where do you see the kind of culmination of your solo career? So, like, when you look back in 40 years' time when you're retired, what would your solo career, you know, have done? Is it about doing a certain amount of records? Is it playing with different people? What do you want to... What's the goal from your own solo perspective?
Well, because I think, for me, it would be a... It's always going to be a slow burn, because I guess, so much enjoyment out of being a session musician, and the opportunities that has given me are amazing. And so to become a solo artist as a saxophonist will take a lot of time. And also, I think now I've only just gathered enough of my own material to play live. So I suppose my aim would be to feel as confident and have as much self-belief in playing that music live as I do playing as a session musician and playing other people's music, which will probably take a lot of time. And I don't know if that's surprising to some people, but even if I've played huge fancy pop gigs with the 1975, if I was to then play my own music in fronting a band, and, you know, there being even just a tiny little chalkboard outside of a pub that says the John Waugh Quartet or something, it would scare the shit out of me. And it would take a long time for me to find the confidence to do that regularly. And, you know, and so I suppose in my early 40s, I'll be there. And I think I've had that mindset for a while, because a lot of the musicians that I really, really admire are about maybe 10 or 15 years ahead of me. Not to expose the age of Bob, I'm sure he wouldn't mind, but he is roughly 10 years older than me. And when I'd look, I can't make a direct comparison between myself and him in terms of quality of playing, because he just is, on an empirical level, better than I am, kind of, you know, subjectively. He just is, and I'm happy to say that it's okay. But in terms of his career, and I suppose the opportunities that he had in his late 20s, early 30s, the timing of when he released music and how that's, you know, how things have progressed for him, I suppose I use his timeline as a reference. And so it has to be a slow burn, because I'm a jazz saxophonist. There are very few jazz musicians these days who are young and have the means to tour, and for it to be financially worth it and viable. And in fact, there was an interesting conversation I overheard between Bob and Lamar, the trombone player Lamar. He was saying to Bob that, you know, he has original music that has been recorded, but he doesn't know what to do with it. Mm. He doesn't know if is it worth putting out, and should I try and be a solo artist? And Bob was saying that, you know, if you're going to do that, you really have to dedicate a huge amount of time to it. You really have to do it a certain way and do it well and invest a lot of time into it and be willing to, you know, just the trial and error involved, I suppose. And the good thing is that I think jazz music is starting to grow well, and it's in a better place than it was 10 years ago, and that is probably down to things like Instagram and YouTube, because it's, you know, regardless of how good or bad the message is, anyone can have a platform to communicate their message. So if you're a particularly talented 21-year-old saxophonist, you can gain a following and people have an invested interest in you being a talented saxophonist, which is great. Mm-hmm. There's a guy called Ryan Devlin who's a brilliant example of that. I don't know exactly where he is based, but he's in the US, and he's just an insanely gifted musician that I would never have heard of if I didn't have an Instagram account, you know what I mean? And so I think now to be able to utilize that will be in my favor, I think, but I'd rather take my time with it, and I'm in no rush to become a renowned solo artist. I want to be held in high regard as a session musician first, because it's serves me well and I want to build on it.
Would love to like analyze why, you know, you said that if you saw in the chalk written, you know, the John Wolf quartet, that scared the shit out of you. It's just like, love to analyze that. It's just like, well, yeah. You know, it's we're not going to do it now, but I just think, you know, hopefully in 10 years time, you know, that you'll be in a position where that doesn't scare the shit out of you, because you've got the experience. Yeah. You've got the, you know, things have happened, and it's just such an interesting, you know, thing that I'm sure if you did do that now, you'd smash it. I mean, look at the ones that you did in our supper club, like they were kind of similar kind of things to that, really. It's like the two of you, you know, it's quite exposed, and you smashed it.
I think I imagine I would lean heavily on the people that would be in my band, I suppose. There's a certain level of comfort that I have playing with Aaron Kine, because I've known him for years, and the same with guys like George Solanos, Dave Lowry, and Freddie Sheed, and Jamie Squire. I can sit with them in a room and play music and play in front of anyone, and there's this a degree of comfort which is just so great. And it's not that it's safe and that I can't try and push myself, it's just they just provide a really good foundation to work on, because they're
surrounding yourself with the right people.
Yeah, of course.
So that you know that you can just trust and concentrate on what you're doing, so you know that if now. See, there you go. Just say 5 years. You can do it 5 years earlier. You can nail it. You don't have to shoot yourself anymore.
We'll
right. So thank you so much for your appearance on the StageLeft podcast. You're the first person out of like whatever it is, about 100 episodes, to appear twice. We've explored so many different areas of your career, and you know, I'm sure we'll visit this again further on down the line. Good luck with the book and obviously the lessons as well, so people can contact you one-to-one. What's the website we can get them on?
It's johnwaughmusic.co.uk.
Cool. Okay, so do go and check that out. Shall we have a flaneur and go and get a beer?
Yes, absolutely.
Let's do that.
Hey up, this is Chris from the StageLeft podcast. Thanks for all the feedback for the episodes with Miles Copeland III, Gail Ann Dorsey, and Mike Smith from the Gorillaz. It's been a pretty whirlwind last kind of 2 or 3 months for us. So my partner and I had our first baby 8 weeks ago, and baby was born early, and we had quite a dramatic and unique experience. In fact, the birth we had statistically works out as like we were told like 1.25 million births, something like that. We had a home birth, but it was an undetected breached birth, which if anyone knows what that means will know how heavy that is and what kind of went down from there. And those who don't, it's basically like the baby came out the wrong way, but if it's detected, you're just going for a cesarean in most cases, and it's deemed too dangerous to do as a home birth. Well, we unfortunately only were told that the baby was breached as she was coming out. So it ended up being a bit touch and go, but thankfully everyone is okay. And it was a bit of a challenging last few weeks. We had a little baby girl. Her name is Eliza Day. So for any of the musos listening to this, which most of you are, you might be thinking, Eliza Day, where do I know that name from? Well, some of you will know Nick Cave did a song with Kylie Minogue in the mid-90s, a duet called Where the Wild Roses Grow. And Kylie's character in the song is called Eliza Day, as a kind of a first name and a surname. And we've decided to kind of pinch that and have it as a double-barreled first name with a Z instead of the S in Eliza, because the baby's half Lithuanian, so Dovila, my partner, is Lithuanian, and the Z translates better. So Eliza Day is with us, and she's well, and her mum's well, and we're just doing the whole kind of getting up five times a night to change nappies and stuff, which is just a privilege to be in that position, to be honest. So yeah, podcasts, we're back now. John is a close friend of ours now. You know, we've spent a lot of time in the last kind of 3 or 4 years, both kind of as running partners. I've done kind of 3 or 4 half marathons together, and just really lovely guy. In fact, Dovida always says, John, he's such a nice boy. He's such a nice guy. He's such a nice person, which sadly you don't always get in the music industry. And John just is just a gentleman. And he speaks about his grandfather, actually, and talked about his own qualities as a grandfather and what he was like. And I kind of was listening to it just thinking he was describing himself. So kind of John has really inherited these qualities that he really admired in his grandfather. And there's certainly qualities that I admire, and my partner does too, in the time that we've kind of hung out with him a lot. It was a really fun episode. John, he came on the podcast 4 years ago, and he's played saxophone with him, the 1975, for all that period. Also playing with Sam Fender on his number one record, and has done loads of other interesting stuff. He very kindly asked me to write his intro to a book that he's just released for new musicians, so you might want to check that out. And also, he's got a new EP out as well. So yeah, podcasts, we're back now. Thanks for all the feedback for the episodes with Miles Copeland III, Gail Ann Dorsey, and Mike Smith from the Gorillaz. So go to thestageleftpodcast.com for all episodes featuring members of Radiohead, Supergrass, Jungle, Queen, Gorillaz, Earth, Wind & Fire, Guns N' Roses, Fleetwood Mac, Madness, Oasis, The Zootons, The Prodigy, and Kraftwerk, where they discuss their writing, recording, and performing processes, as well as reflective interviews with musicians and producers who've worked in the studio and on stage with The Beatles, Beyoncé, Elvis Presley, and David Bowie. And our amazing new branding has been done by Bastian Hues, and you can get in touch with him on Instagram Bastian Hues, which is BastianHues. Drop him a DM and he'll have a chat with you about your next project.
So that's it for now. We hope you enjoyed it. Please get in touch and give us feedback, and check out former episodes if you haven't heard them yet. Thanks so much. See you.